Well, hello, gospel men, hello, gospel sons, and hello, gospel brothers. Hey, thanks for joining me today. I'm Kevin Pierpont, and I want to welcome you from wherever you are. I am grateful that you have decided to listen to or watch this podcast today. I am so glad that you are here and listening along. I call this podcast A Gospel Man, and my purpose is to encourage you and challenge you to be a godly man, a man who loves the Lord and lives fearlessly for Jesus Christ with every day he gives you. I started this podcast because, well, I have 7 adult sons I'm still trying to encourage in their walk with the Lord. And I am also doing this podcast because I'm a pastor and I'm concerned for the men in our own church that they be encouraged and challenged to be godly men. And I also started this podcast because I'm concerned for young men that they have something challenging and encouraging to listen to. And even though there are a lot of good resources like this to encourage young men, I don't think we can have too many. And then I also started making this podcast for men because my brother Ken, who was a faithful pastor for many years before he went home to be with the Lord in February of this year, 2024, he had been making a podcast for men for almost a year, and I found that very encouraging and helpful. So as best I can, I'm trying to carry on something my brother Ken did so well. Now, when I started this podcast a few weeks ago, I started by sharing with you what I mean by a gospel man and what it means to be a gospel man and what it looks like in the life of a man or a young man to be a gospel man. And I started with this, that a gospel man is a man of faith in Jesus Christ. And then I said that you cannot be a man of faith in Jesus, a man who is growing in his faith in Jesus, without God's word. So I said, you've got to read your Bible to grow in your faith. I hope that's your desire, to grow in your faith. And that's what I'm getting at when I'm talking about being a gospel man. You've got to be a man of faith. And so that's kind of the series that I'm on right now, a man of faith. And what does it look like to be a man of faith? And I'm just going to deal with that again today. And then in the last episode, I started challenging you with 8 reasons that you need to read your Bible. 8 reasons for reading your Bible. And I gave you last time the first 4 of those 8. And today I'm going to give you the next 3. The next 3 of 8 reasons you need to read your Bible. And then, Lord willing, next time I'll deal with the 8th one. But let's start with some review of the 4 from last week. But first, I guess I don't want to get ahead of myself here. First, I want you to hear something from Charles Spurgeon. He was a great man of God and a great preacher in the 1800s. And he's one of my favorite of the dead guys who faithfully serve the Lord. Now, listen to what he says about the Bible. He writes, "There seems to me to have been twice as much done in some ages in defending the Bible as in expounding it. But if the whole of our strength shall henceforth go to the exposition and spreading of it, we may leave it pretty much to defend itself. I do not know whether you see that lion. It is very distinctly before my eyes. A number of persons advance to attack him, while a host of us would defend the grand old monarch, that lion, with all our strength. Many suggestions are made, and much advice is offered. This weapon is recommended, and the other. Pardon me, he says, if I offer a quiet suggestion. Open the door and let the lion out. He will take care of himself. Why, they are gone. He no sooner goes forth in his strength than his assailants flee. The way to meet infidelity is to spread the Bible. The answer to every objection against the Bible is the Bible." Well, let that lion out, says Spurgeon. I like it. That's Spurgeon on the strength of the Bible. And I think that's a good way to think of it in your life as a man of faith, a gospel man. You need the strength and the power of God's word in your life, in your heart, in your mind. Why? Well, you need it to overpower and defeat the foolishness of mankind that's all around you. You need the wisdom of God's work at work in you. You need the wisdom of God working in you that only comes from getting God's word into your life. And the gospel, the Bible, it's like a lion. Let it out of the cage, men. Get it into your life to do its mighty work in you as God intended. Listen to Hebrews 4 and verse 12 and to what the writer of Hebrews, inspired by God, says about God's word, the Bible. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. My word, gentlemen, if the Bible isn't like a lion, then I don't know what it is like. That Hebrews 4:12 passage makes it really clear. God's word is living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerns the thoughts and intentions of the heart. So, men, here's what I'm saying. You need the Bible. And young men, you're not exempt. You need the Bible too. So before we get into the next three reasons for reading your Bible, I'll give you a quick review of the first four reasons for reading your Bible. And I talked about these last time. So if you didn't get these, go back and listen to the previous podcast. It's about how to be a man of faith and eight reasons why you need to read your Bible. Here's the first four we talked about last time. Here's why you need to read your Bible, men, because the Bible is God's word. Think of that. Creator of the universe gave us a book. That book is the Bible. And in that book, God is speaking to you, men. When you read your Bible, God is speaking to you. The Bible is God's word. And because the Bible is God's word, the Bible shows you the way to salvation from your sin. That's the second reason you need to read the Bible. The Bible shows you the way to salvation from your sin. The third reason for reading your Bible is because the Bible prepares you to serve God and the people around you. And you need to serve God and the people around you. That's how God intends for you to live. And then the fourth reason for reading your Bible is because the Bible will help you learn to live smart. That's just my simple way of saying it will help you learn to live God's way. God's word will help you learn to live God's way. And listen, guys, God's way is the only way to true joy, true contentment, true exaltation of God with your life and worship of God with the way that you live and do your work. The only way to truly live life is God's way, and I call that the smart way. So the Bible will help you learn to live smart. Now, let's think about reason number five. So we're going to get into the next three of eight. Here's reason number five for why you need to read your Bible. Number five, the Bible teaches you to recognize sin in your life. Hear that. The Bible teaches you to recognize sin in your life. So read the Bible. Read God's word. Listen to this passage. Here's a passage from Psalm 119, verses 9 through 11. Which says this, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I have stored up your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. How can you learn, gentlemen, to recognize that you are not being obedient to God? Psalm 119 and verse 9 is telling you that you need the word of God to guard the way you live. God's word will help guard you from living in unrepentant sin. That is, just doing the same sin over and over again without recognizing your need to repent of your sin before God. When you recognize that you are sinning and you repent, you are agreeing with God that what you have done is wrong. But if you fail to repent, you're rebelling against God, and you're rebelling against His righteous commands for how you ought to live. So you are sinning against God, and you are disagreeing with God that you are sinning. How foolish is that? But if you will see your sin for what it is, a lack of obedience to God and a weakness of faith in God, then you can thank Him for His forgiveness that's already yours in Christ, and you can seek to turn from that sin with His help. So Psalm 119:9 says, how can a young man keep his way pure? Here's how: by guarding it according to your word, according to God's word, you guard your heart. So get the word in, gentlemen. So read the Bible, because it teaches you to recognize sin in your life, and then it helps you to deal with it God's way. And for that to happen, you need the word to dwell in you richly, says Colossians 3:16. You see, the Bible will teach you and admonish you, and it will instruct your heart. It will teach your mind. It'll correct you when you sin. Verse 10 makes it clear there in that Psalm 119 passage. Verse 10 is clear that the follower of the Lord who seeks Him with his or her whole heart will have the help of the Lord. The Bible is a spiritual book, so God does a spiritual work in your heart and life when you seek Him with all your heart. And then in Psalm 119, verse 11, we have this focus. The focus is on your need to continually read the Bible when the psalmist says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Gentlemen, you cannot store up God's word in your heart that you might not sin against Him if you aren't reading the Bible for yourself. And so men and young men, make a plan, develop a routine that gets you reading your Bible every day, because it will teach you to recognize sin in your life so that you can repent of that sin, so that you can thank God for the forgiveness He's already given you in Christ, and so that you can then take steps to turn from that sin and turn to obedience. That leads us to the sixth reason you need to read the Bible. Read the Bible, men, because the Bible helps you turn from sin and to obedience. When you read the Bible, it will help you turn from sin and turn to obedience. Or maybe we change the order and make it like this. The Bible will help you to turn to obedience and from sin. You always need to do both. You can't just turn from sin. You also need to turn to obedience. The Bible is a spiritual book, and our lives are spiritual. And there are spiritual forces at work in our lives. You cannot see them, but they are there. So you need spiritual help to turn to obedience and from sin. So listen to Ephesians 6. Let me share with you verses 12 through 18. This is an important passage, so listen carefully. Ephesians 6, verses 12 through 18. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert, with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Men, listen, you may not see the enemy, because the enemy is spiritual, but God has given you spiritual armor to take up and put on, that will not only guard you from sin, but will also help you pursue obedience. But how foolish you would be to not take up and put on the armor God has given you to help you turn to obedience and from sin. Hey, tell you something about many years ago that was true of my life. And I was a young man. I served in the Marines for a few years and I was given much training. In fact, I was constantly being trained. Boy, those Marines, they like to train and train and train. And we constantly trained. And I was given weapons and I was given armor and I was given a duty to carry out, a job to do. So I was given weapons and I was given armor and I was to use and wear those weapons and armor. And it was going to help me if I were ever in danger on my post, on my place of duty. And I was very fortunate to never have to fight. But I did guard things that were very important to our national security. And it would have been foolish for me to leave behind my weapons and leave behind my armor when going out on duty just because I didn't see the enemy and maybe I thought I didn't really need those things to weigh me down. In fact, if I had left my weapons and left my armor behind, I could have been court-martialed for not doing my duty, for not following orders. Just because I didn't see the enemy didn't mean I could get away with being careless. I had a duty to be vigilant and to guard the things I was being charged with guarding. And men, you have been given a duty to guard your heart and to guard your mind and to guard your soul against the temptations that come from within and the temptations that surround you in this life. God has given you weapons and He has given you armor. And you are to learn how to use them, gentlemen. And you do that first and foremost by taking up the Word of God and pouring it into your life. And this is not just for your own sake. Think of this. This is also for the good of the people in your life. The people you work with, the people you go to church with. If you have a wife, your wife depends upon you for this. If you have children, your children depend upon you for this, for their sake. And for their good, it's vital that you take up the weapons and the armor of your faith, which God has given you to strengthen you, to be a godly example to the people around you, and to lead others in the way that is obedient to God, to lead other people in the truth by your example. And when you have opportunities, to lead them by your teaching. And you will need the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That's verse 17, to help you stand firm in your faith. And then standing firm means that you will pursue obedience. We go back to verse 13 for that. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. You need to stand firm in your faith, not moving, not changing, not turning away from God's word. So men, because the Bible helps you turn from sin and to obedience, read the Bible and pursue the truth of the Bible daily. As Matthew 26:41 says, watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. But God's word can help you, and God's word can help make you strong to turn to obedience and from sin. And it'll help you put off the sinful ways of the old man and what you were before Christ. And it'll help you put on the new man, what you are now in Christ, with the help of the Holy Spirit. This leads us to reason number 7 for why you need to read the Bible. Gentlemen, you need to read the Bible because the Bible helps you avoid error and keep you from being deceived. The Bible helps you avoid error and keeps you from being deceived. Men, we need God's word to train our hearts with the truth so that we can be protected from error and from being deceived by false teaching. In 1 Timothy 6, we're shown the importance of being on guard against error. In fact, all of chapter 6 points to the need to read and submit to God's word so that you can be equipped with the truth, so that you will avoid error, so that you'll be guarded from false teaching and false teachers who would lead you astray from the truth of God's word. Let me just point you to a few passages, a few verses here in 1 Timothy 6. Listen to verses 3 through 5 first. So 1 Timothy 6 verses 3 through 5 says, "If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and deprived of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain." Now listen to verse 11. "But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness." Oh my, listen to that again. Verse 11, you need to hear that again. Here's our charge, men, and here's why we need the word. "But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness." And then verse 12 says this, "Fight the good fight of faith." It kind of sounds like we're in the midst of a spiritual battle, doesn't it? We are, men. We are in a spiritual battle. The fight is spiritual. That's why God wants us to take these things seriously and be men of God, what I would call a gospel man. Now, verses 13 and 14, hear these, gentlemen. "I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ." Do you hear there the challenge to guard the truth, to keep the commandment unstained? Now verses 20 and 21. "O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you." Oh, that's a charge to be true to the truth, to guard the truth of God's word, to know the truth, to guard your own hearts from false teaching. "Avoid the irreverent babble," he goes on to say in verse 20, "and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge, for by professing it, some have swerved from the faith." Gentlemen, if you want to be guarded from error, equipped against error, and guarded from being drawn away by false teaching and false teachers, you need to be guarded from swerving from the faith. And to be guarded from swerving from the faith, you need the truth of God's word. So you need to submit your life to God's word. And you do that by reading the Bible with faith, believing this is God's word and that he is speaking to you from his word into your life. So you need to submit your life to God's word, read the Bible to guard you from error, whether that's error of your own, because you don't understand the word, or because you're being led up by your own sinful desires, or through simply neglecting the scriptures. That's all possible without even being deceived by someone else. We could be led astray because we're just neglecting the truth of God's word, or we're giving into our sinful desires. You also need to read the Bible so that you will be able to spot false teachers and their false teaching and learn to avoid them. So there you have the first seven reasons why you need to read the Bible, men. And I challenge you to take God's word seriously. Put it in your heart. Store it up. So before I go, let me challenge you with this. Let me challenge you with this, gentlemen. I challenge you to make time for reading the Bible this week and make time every day. There are lots of things in our lives that we make time for. And you need to make time for the Bible because your life depends on it. And the people around you, their lives depend on you being a man of the word, a man of faith, a gospel man. So men and young men, will you devote yourself to reading the Bible and reading it again and again, and committing yourself to being a Bible reader for the rest of your life. Hey, listen, reading it once through will never be enough to sustain your life. I told you I liked Charles Spurgeon. Let me give you another quote from him. He said this about our need for God's Word. "Nobody ever outgrows Scripture," says Spurgeon. "The book widens and deepens with our years." That's true. The more you read the Bible, the more you realize you need the Bible and you need to read it again and again. So I challenge you, gentlemen, commit yourself, devote yourself to the daily reading of your Bible for the rest of your life. I challenge you to say with the psalmist, as I read earlier from Psalm 119 and verse 10, "With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments." Let that be your prayer as you read God's word. "Oh God, with my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me wander from your commandments." Well, guys, I have one more reason for reading the Bible, and I'll share it with you next time, Lord willing, as we gather back again next week, if the Lord lets us do that. So, gospel brothers and gospel sons and gospel men, until next week, may God bless you richly with the wisdom of his word, that you might walk faithfully with Jesus and live joyfully each day for the glory of God. Thank you, gentlemen, for listening to or watching this episode of A Gospel Man. For more episodes and to sign up for my newsletter, head over to agospelman.com. And if you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit that like and subscribe buttons. Or if you're listening to the podcast, please rate and review A Gospel Man on your favorite podcast platform so other men can be encouraged to live for Jesus every day as a gospel man.